Hi, I'm Nathaniel.
Hi, I'm Tamana.
And welcome to Design of Machine Elements Spring Lab.
So the objectives for the Spring Lab are to become familiar with the different types of springs used in machine systems, to gain practical experience with compression and extension springs, to investigate series and parallel combinations of springs, to measure characteristics and properties of wire springs and 3D printed springs.
We will be attending four separate lab stations which identify springs both out of and within systems with a series of intentional experiments compressed into video format. Springs are idealized elastic materials which store mechanical energy in the form of potential energy.
Now I will describe the terminology for springs. The free length, or the L sub F, is the overall length of a spring which is not under load. The solid length, L sub S, is the length of a compression spring when no additional shortening is possible. The active coils, N sub A, are the coils which are free to deflect under an applied load. The mean diameter, D, is the average diameter of the mass of spring material. The wire diameter, small d, is the diameter of the wire used to create the spring. The pitch, P, is the distance from center to center of wire in adjacent coils. The deflection, delta, is the displacement due to application or removal of an external load. The spring index, C, is the ratio of the mean diameter to wire diameter.
Springs are commonly produced from metals like spring steel, though they can be formed with other materials like plastics. From the raw, de-reeled wire stock, a forming machine shapes the wire to the desired spring type. Most modern assembly line machines can check tolerance on every single spring with a simple probe and/or picture as they leave the forming machine. For larger springs, wire is heated and spun onto a coiling machine. After shaping, springs are generally quenched and tempered to reduce brittleness and improve elasticity. Once created, springs can be finished in a variety of ways, such as looping the end of the spring, with more loops to prevent premature failure in tension springs, or ground ends on a tension spring to place better within a housing. Note that the number of coils on a spring may be affected by the spring end type. Compression springs are one of the most ubiquitous spring types. Compressional springs are designed to operate under axial compression load. In the figure here, there are several types of compression springs shown. Note that not all of the springs have a constant spring rate, which is to say that the slopes of the stress versus strain for the elastic region of that spring is not constant. Variable stiffness springs are useful in applications where designers need proportional response to a shock, balancing compliance, which makes for smooth operation without transferring load directly to a machine frame. Tension or extension springs are designed to operate under axial tension load. These are designed with hooks or eyes, which can attach to other components. Torsional springs are loaded under a torque rather than a force, rotating at a given angle as load is applied. Torsional springs also commonly exist as double torsional springs, which can exert greater torque and have the added benefit of being symmetric in design. Spring washers are useful for handling large axial loads in tight spaces. Wave springs are essentially stacked wave washers and are easier to handle and install. Of course, there are many other types of springs, and not all have that characteristic helical shape. Materials can be coiled or even rigidly supported to create a spring mechanism. Many common materials and mechanisms have spring-like properties, which prevent permanent plastic deformation and shattering. Here we can see a tensile test, which will test the springiness in a material. This linear section of the stress-strain diagram reveals a material's constant spring rate. After the material passes beyond its elastic range, transitioning through its yield point, the material begins to strain harden. This continues until the strength of the material levels off to its ultimate tensile strength. The material then begins to neck in plastic deformation before breaking in complete failure. Now that we have a basic understanding of springs, let's see if we can apply that knowledge in lab. See you at Station 1!
Now take a look at spring number 1. Now this is spring number 2. And this is spring number 3. Now I'll show you spring number 4. Now this is spring number 5. Now take a look at spring number 6. Now take a look at spring number 7. Now this is spring number 8. Now this is spring number 9. So here you can see the end. And this is spring number 10.
Okay, so now we're going to examine a Strattec rear seat back latch. I'm gonna just flip it forward so you can examine it more closely.
Can you see the torsional spring inside here? You can? It should be right there. Okay, ready?
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to push on this latch. You can see what happens to the springs on the inside. And as I pull it back, this is the latch. When I push it all the way forward, you can see that the latch re-engages. Note that the clamping mechanism does not fully lock until it fully engages with its corresponding attachment point. Now we're going to analyze an automotive key fob with a flip-out key. So I want you to notice here how the key has two mechanisms that are going on here. One, you have a depressible button and you push it in and then it pushes back out. The other thing that's going on here is watch how the key flips out. Wonder what's going on inside. Like one of those BBGBs again, black box gearboxes. So I'm gonna use some brute force here. Pop this sucker open. So inside you can see places for the buttons to be pushed. And then we have off to the side a little bit of
printed circuit boards. You can see this is what the pads push on. It's very cool and electronic, but the thing that we want to focus on here is the key mechanism itself. So here we have some sort of a selector button, and on the inside we have some of these pins on this shaft. Presumably these lock the key in positions. And then we've got this really long spring right here. So when we push the button, it pushes back. And also, if you look inside of this key channel, it's all very straight. That must mean that there's something. Yep. I can only twist this key portion a certain way, so watch what happens when I start twisting that. And then when I release.
Hello, and welcome to station number 2, where we will be looking at 3 different locks. So, to start, I'm gonna disassemble this American lock. So I start by putting the key inside the lock. That's a good sign I've chosen the right lock. So you can see the shackle has been released. In order to disassemble that lock, I'm going to remove this little bit of a screw that's in the side of the shackle. Get my screwdriver in there. And that's going to release a threaded rivet on the back here that's shielding the locking mechanism. Right out there. And then I'm going to pop out the rivet. Okay, with that free, I can now remove the front shield. And then I'm just going to pop out this tumbler. And then I have a tumbling mechanism right on the inside here. Got to beat a little bit on it. There we go. And you can see we got a tumbling mechanism. I want you to get a good look at that spring there. What do you think that's used for? And then I want you to make note of this cutout right here on the front of the gear. You can see that cutout matches up pretty well with the ball bearing. I'm going to set that right here. That other side, on the shackle, you also have that cutout right there. So that mates up really well with that ball bearing as well, and that's the thing that locks it in place. So that frees it where it can freely pass, and then if it's blocked off on one section, it won't allow the ball bearing to pass. So, ball's free to move. I'm gonna put that mechanism right there. If you look at the casing right here, see, I've labeled up a spring, and that spring is just a very convenient thing. It's when you've unlocked the lock right here, it just pops the shackle right back out. Really convenient, not 100% necessary, kind of pops it out. Gives you a good feeling that you've unlocked the lock. I'm going to set that there, then I'm going to put my spring on the outside. Now inside of this barrel tumbler, there are a number of pins and pin springs. Now it's a little bit finicky to take that apart, so I've taken the initiative here. I'm just going to slide this onto place, and I've removed the springs and pins. I'll flip this around. No, that's the right. Okay. Now if you look at the key, you'll see that the keyway has some bumps. And the springs and the pins will allow you to either turn this or not turn it. So this has been the examination of the American lock. I'll see if I can't make some closer up shots to include.
So let's head on to our next padlock. So up next we have our cutaway lock.
And then finally, a clearly superior lock.
In the first part of Station 3, we will examine springs in compression. In order to conduct this section properly, you will need to know the following formula: for Hooke's law, the equation of a linear coil spring, and the equation of spring rate. Before we examine springs in compression, let's get a couple of spring characteristics.
The free length for the 3D printer spring is 4.091. The wire diameter for the 3D printer spring is 0.327. So count the number of coils for the 3D printer spring. So the outer diameter of the 3D printer spring is 1.771. The internal diameter for the 3D printed spring is 1.064. Now please calculate the mean diameter of the 3D printed spring. The free length of the wire is 5.045. The wire diameter for the wire is 0.058. Now count the number of coils for the wire. The outer diameter of the wire is 1.251. The inner diameter for the wire is 1.154. Now calculate the mean diameter for the wire.
Now we'll measure the deflection for the 3D printed spring. So here, I will put that spring inside, and now I will keep that platform over that spring. After that, I will apply the load. So I will apply a 2-pound load. Okay, so we already know the free length of the spring. Now we can measure the deflection. So from the scale, it looks like the deflection for the 3D printer spring is 0.25 inch. So now we'll remove this load. Now we'll measure the deflection for the wire. So we can put it here, then the platform. And then again, I'm applying the same 2-pound load. So it looks like the deflection for the wire is 2.17 inch. Okay, I'm removing this part.
For this next subsection, let's examine springs under torsional load. This time, we will need some additional formula to describe the downward force on the compression spring. Here you can see the formula, where theta is the angular displacement, and F is the downward force on the compression spring. Note that in this setup, we have a carbon steel spring with a shear modulus of 11.5 MPSI, a pair of characteristic spring constants, C1 and C2, and a radius R, 0.325 inches, which is the radius from the center axis of rotation to the contact point.
Okay. Now we'll measure the torsion of a compression spring. And for this experiment, we will use the torque wrench to measure the torsional load. And like for different radial distance or radial displacement, you will get different torque, and after that you will calculate the spring rate. So to start, like this is now in the zero position, so we are not applying any load, so the torque is zero. Now I will move a little bit to 0 to 10 degree radial distance. Now from the torque wrench I am getting 5.8 inch pound torque. Then I will move a little bit up to 15 degree, and for this range I am getting torque 15.7 inch pound. Then I will move up to 20 degree now, and at 20 degree radial distance I am getting 18.9 inch pound. Now I will move a little bit up to 25 degree, and here I am getting the torque 21.6 inch pound. Okay. So now you can calculate the spring rate.
In station 4, we are going to be using a cart and spring mechanism to determine a spring system's yield point in single, parallel, and series configurations.
In order to measure the maximum force the spring can handle, we're going to have to stretch this spring to the limit. Stop! The following experiment is dangerous. Remember to wear your safety squints.
All joking aside, let's take a brief moment to measure the properties of the springs.
Okay, let's measure some important spring characteristics. Let's do the unstretched length. It looks like the unstretched length is about 0.738 inches. Let's measure the outer diameter, which is a little bit more than the average diameter, but let's just use the outer diameter. The outer diameter of the spring is about 0.275 inches. Let's measure the wire thickness finally. Wire thickness is about 0.025 inches.
Okay, now let's measure each of those spring systems.
Let's measure the force and extension for a single spring. Now let's measure the force and displacements for two springs in parallel.
Unfortunately, our scale doesn't read any higher. Now let's measure two springs in series.
Thank you for joining us for Spring Lab.
Okay, there we go.
Okay, so
there should be a good take in there.
Knows it's Slinky, the best present yet to give or get, but costs a little to buy. The hit of the day when you're ready to play, everyone knows it's Slinky. It's Slinky, it's Slinky, for fun it's the best of the toys. It's Slinky, it's Slinky, the favorite of girls and boys. It's Slinky, it's Slinky, for fun it's the best of the toys. It's Slinky, it's Slinky, the favorite of girls and boys. Everyone wants a Slinky, you ought to get a Slinky.